بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحابته أجمعين وعلى من اتبع هداه وسن بسنته واهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله سبحانه وتعالى، وخير الهدي هدي نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، حبة الكرام، إن شاء الله سبحانه وتعالى بإذن الكريم جل في علاه تدي إن شاء الله سبحانه وتعالى بالصاء أو تفسير السد. And الحمد لله أخونا يوسف he already began his lesson. But إن شاء الله سبحانه وتعالى we just I feel like we need to speak about يعني very important سورة. This سورة you just to ask yourself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is asking us to recite it every day, at least 17 times. Just only for fara'id, if you read only in fara'id, you must read it at least, how many times? 17, which is Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's Surah Al-Fatiha. And he has so many secrets. It has to be a secret. It has to be a reason. Something has to be repeated every day 17 times. If you add the sunnah, you add the nafil, then it goes beyond what? 30 times, sometimes even more. Taraweeh, every time you start the imam, first, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Surah Al-Fatiha, then the surah after. And this surah, yeah, you see the virtue of the surah. First of all, subhanAllah, my dear brothers and sisters, I would like to start my lesson about Surah Al-Fatiha about very, very interesting يعني, hadith and story. And that inshallah gives us indication this surah, subhanAllah, how important this is surah. يعني عندما الحديث الذي رواه أبو موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه وأرضاه لما خرج الصحابة في بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he sent an expedition. الصحابة they went outside the Medina for a task, for a mission. And then they came across a tribe. And this tribe, they were extremely stingy, or I don't know what's going on. They didn't accommodate them. They didn't host them. They were very harsh with them. To the point, the Sahaba, they felt like sad. They felt disappointed. So they stayed outside this place. And they said, next day we'll move on. And subhanAllah, qadr Allah, sabiq wa ghalib. In that night, the chief of the tribe got bitten. Snake bit him, and the Arab at that time, they used to believe, even before Islam, كانوا يؤمنون بالرقى. رقى كلام يقال ويرقى به الإنسان يرجى فيه يرجى فيه ماذا؟ الشفاء. They used to believe in ruqya. Ruqya would say statement, words about Allah. Sometimes not about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes has shirk with their idols and statues. So when the chief of the tribe got bitten, he said, let us seek help. So they went to the Sahaba, companions. هل فيكم الراقي؟ هل فيكم من يرقي أو من عنده دواء أو شفاء؟ So, do you have anyone who can offer a medicine or رقية؟ They said, okay, you were very harsh with us. If you had accommodated us, we would have given you for free. But no, we're going to give you but in a condition. What is the condition? You give us a reward. You have to pay for that. We're going to charge you. So this is our service. قالوا لا بأس. Okay, then one of the Sahaba said, I will do that. And even he was not known that Sahabi was ordinary Sahabi. He went, قال فقرأ على سيدهم فما زاد على الفاتحة. He went and he recited only Surah Al-Fatiha. He did not recite other than this Surah Al-Fatiha. So he decided that the moment he finished it, the chief started feeling better. Until he got completely fine. And then he started walking. And then, subhanAllah, they gave him the reward. It was like a flock of sheep. He said, listen, no, wait. We're not going to touch, we're not going to take anything. We don't know, it is a permissible income. It is a halal for us. Look, subhanAllah, sahab, يعني عندهم هذا الإيمان حس حلال أم حرام. Is a halal income, is it permissible for us? Well, subhanAllah, the brothers, the first question if you ask, if you were to offer like a business, say, how much profit will you make? Is there, there's a risk? They don't offer, they don't ask the first question, is it halal or haram? Is it riba or something haram? No. The first question, is can we make profit with it? No. But Sahaba, subhanAllah, they were very, يعني, the iman is very high. قال then they waited until they reached the Medina and they asked the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He turned to the one who recited the Fatiha. He said, how did you know the Fatiha has a cure? Because the Quran, what it was, قال الله سبحانه وتعالى وينزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء. The Quran, some of the ayat, can be physical cure. Physical cure, not just only spiritual, can be physical cure. But of course, we have to believe in it. And Ibn Qayyim كان يقول السيف بضاربه. You believe in the Quran, but you have to believe in it. If someone has got a very strong weapon, sword, but you give it to a little child, what is he going to do with it? He's going to harm himself, he's going to hurt himself. But if you give it to a strong knight, very brave knight, soldier, or commander, he would deal with it, he would really fight bravely. So that's different. And in the Quran is a great cure. But of course, when you recite it, مع الإيمان واليقين, you have إيمان, you have يقين in every ayah, and you know certainly the cure in it. بإذن الله will be more than enough, will be sufficient. Then the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to him, no, just give me a share, how will not just him? And the Nabi, he took a share of the reward of the sheep to give them, subhanAllah, indication. It is not only permissible. The Nabi, he had some of the sheep. That gives an indication. First of all, you can't do ruqyah for the non-Muslims because the chief was what? Non-Muslim. So if someone asks you, your neighbor, said, I'm sick, I'm not feeling well, and you are Muslim, and you visit him, why not to do some prayers and read the Quran? You don't have to read the surah and make them scary. Read it nicely with nice ayat. Don't read the ayat of the adab. Read the surah al-Fatiha. Yeah, don't read the ayat of talaq. Yeah, read the ayat, which ayat is relevant to them. أحبتي الكرام, سورة الفاتحة من أعظم أسرارها أن فيها الشفاء. That has a cure. And there's so many آيات and حديث about the benefit or the virtue of سورة الفاتحة. As the brother said, we're not going to make it too long for you, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like around 15-20 minutes, inshallah. If I go over that, just give me a sign. يعني politely, yeah? And then inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, finish it. طبعا أحبة الكرام من سورة الفاتحة من أسمائها أنها أم الكتاب. و first of all, طبعا هي سورة الفاتحة وهي لأنها تستفتح الكتاب. فاتحة الكتاب that means the opening of the book. So you open it, and that's why in Hadith عبادة that the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم named it صلى الله عليه وسلم بفاتحة الكتاب, سماها النبي. So one of the يعني الأسماء that النبي has given to سورة الفاتحة is فاتحة الكتاب. One of the names of سورة الفاتحة is القرآن. القرآن أم القرآن which is the mother of the كتاب القرآن. طبعا العلماء يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال هي أم القرآن والسبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم. القرآن العظيم when you say the mother of the book because Allah سبحانه وتعالى what he calls Allah summarized the most important thing is Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah summarized the most important objectives and goals in the Quran and he made a summary, very intense summary in Surah Al-Fatiha. And the most important thing in Surah Al-Fatiha, what was? What is it? The ayat, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ إياك نعبد. سبحان الله يجوري في اللغة العربية تبدأ تقول نعبد إياك ونستعين بك، لكن هذا التقديم والتأخير يفيد الاختصاص على ماذا؟ على يفيد الاختصاص إياك you alone worship and you alone seek for help. هذا يدلنا على أعظم صفات المؤمن، أعظم صفات أهل الإيمان الاستعانة بالله وعبادة الله وحده، وهو أن يكون عبدا. لذلك الله سبحانه وتعالى عندما مدح نبيه بأعظم مدح في سورة الإسراء مدحه بقوله سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده. First, the most important thing as Muslims, the very important quality as a Muslim is you are a slave of Allah. You are slave of Allah. What does it mean slave? You are ready to implement the orders. ما كان ولا مميت إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيرة من أمرهم. When Allah says something, you only say سمعنا وأطعنا. إياك نعبد. العبادة لله جل وعلا. الله سبحانه وتعالى وإياك نستعين. We only seek help from yours. Subhanallah. You alone worship, you alone, we seek for help. And that's why Allah سبحانه وتعالى says that the mu'min, whenever he has this quality, that he solely, purely seek help from Allah, then Allah will definitely, certainly will help him. قال إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. So that's why it's called أم القرآن. And سبع المثاني سبع المثاني من يثنى يعني صغيرة وتثنى يعني it's very short as you know سورة المكية usually what short النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم most of his صلاة the Quran is divided into categories one of the categories is المثاني المثاني عن المفصل المفصل يعني من سورة فصلت إلى سورة الناس And then he said, he would, most of the time, he would read in his salah from Al-Mufassal. From Al-Mufassal. Mufassal mainly, primarily focused on Aqeedah. Build up your Iman, your faith. Your Iman. Because my dear brothers, my advice, you know, every time you would like to approach people, you reach out people, you want to speak to them, the very important thing, Before you talk about the restrictions and the rules and of the deen, you talk about you make that foundation. And the foundation is the belief. Like Aisha radiallahu anha wa radha, ماذا كانت تقول رضي الله عنها؟ قال أول ما نزل من القرآن ذكر الجنة والنار حتى إذا ثاب الناس نزل الحلال والحرام. ولو نزل الحلال والحرام قبل ذلك لما آمن الناس. يعني The first revelation was about what? To attract people about Jannah and to warn them against Jahannam, about the belief. About Jannah now, Iman Billah. Foundation, the six pillars of belief. Iman Billah, Rasul, Malaikati. So until when the Iman becomes solid in their heart, then they were ready to what? To receive the rules and regulations and restrictions. Then the ayat of Khamr, the prohibition of Khamr, came down. When did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal the prohibition of khamr? When was that? After how many years? يعني كم سنة؟
ستة؟
لا
كم مو من 30 ينوع حمزة بن أبي طالب جبار عن الله يعني after بدر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he was drunk he was completely drunk because at the end after غزوة بدر still is disliked and they are only allowed to drink alcohol just after عشاء because by the time فجر comes they will be okay so Allah سبحانه وتعالى it will stage gradually Allah سبحانه وتعالى prohibited the خمر the first day فيها منافع للناس وفيها مضار الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة البقرة ماذا قال سبحان الله غلط المالي الخمر والبقر فيهما إثم كبير ومنافع للناس there's some benefit then Allah سبحانه وتعالى said after that يا أهل الذين آمنوا لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى don't come close to the salah when you are drunk and then came down that إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجسوا من أمر الشيطان فاجتنبوا avoid so that was three stages so the point was after 15 years of Islam revelation until Allah سبحانه وتعالى send down salt ayat permission of God because for them nobody was they used to, as you know يعني كلنا أنه كانوا يخزنون الخمر كما يخزن أحد ما إيش الزيت والشراب والشاي وغيره they used to store or restore alcohol الخمر the way how we have tea and drink whatever very attached very obsessed with alcohol they used to make sure of praising and glorifying to the point they would worship khamr. For them it's like it's kind of alien. The way it's, it's like shops now, they call it what, majestic, isn't it? And subhanAllah, wallah, clicked me, it's the same idea of kuffar. They used to worship al-khamr. So it took for 15 years until they comprehended. Now it's easy for them to what? When to give up drinking alcohol. So someone becomes Muslim, and the first thing you tell him, you need to, and he's very obsessed. Like when you find it, you can see. So start with him gradually. Don't do it and feel destined himself to be mad. Oh, listen, you need to give up this, you need to give up this. The most important, let him have the iman established, the belief, at least believe in Allah. Do your salah, the basic, stick to the basic. And inshallah, eventually, hopefully, when he, mashallah, has the iman, strong iman, he will give up. But even if he dies upon shirk, drinking alcohol, he's still what? He's still Muslim. But don't make an obstacle for you. If you don't give up your drinking alcohol, if you don't give up your girlfriend, you're not going to be Muslim. You're not going to accept you. No, that's not right. That's not the correct way of da'wah. Let him become Muslim. And then after that, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi'idhina, gradually, he will pick up that positive habit of Islam. طبعا من أسمائها سورة الحمد تبدأ بالحمد لله رب العالمين. And my dear brothers, that's why النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في الصحيح قال أنس بن مالك قال صليت خلف أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي قال وكنت فما سمعت أحد منهم يجهر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يبدأ فاتحة by reciting الحمد لله and he would say بسم الله quietly that's why Most vast majority of the ulama, I would say all of the ulama, not all of them. They differ, there's different opinions, of course. But one of the opinions which is very, I feel is the most strongest opinion, is you read Bismillah quietly and you start your Fatiha. Because this hadith, and this hadith Qudusi. Hadith Qudusi, قال قسمت الصلاة بيني وبين عدي نصفين. I have split up and divided salah between me and my slave into two parts. So, and then Nabi started by saying, قال فإذا قال العبد الحمد لله رب العالمين. If my slave when he says الحمد لله, what would say? قال حمدني عبدي. So the hadith, what did he say? فإذا قال عبدي الحمد لله. He did not start by saying فإذا قال عبدي بسم الله. So that's why the ulama they derived and they extracted from this hadith that the first ayah, Alhamdulillah, and you should start by saying Alhamdulillah. Of course, you still have to say Bismillah quietly. فَإِذَا قَالَ عَبْدِي الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبَّنَا قَالَ حَمَدَنِي عَبْدِي. He has thanked me. Alhamdulillah, رَبَّنَا. Then, قَالَ الْحَمْدُ. فَإِذَا قَالَ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ قَالَ أَثْنَى عَلَيَّ عَبْدِي. My abd has praised me. That's what my was. Very important sunnah. Sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كان إذا أراد أن يدعو كان يبدأ بالثناء والحمد على الله الحمد لله قبل أن يبدأ المسألة. الله سبحانه وتعالى يحب المدح. الله سبحانه وتعالى loves to be praised, to be glorified. So the next time when he used to make his dua, he would start his dua by praising Allah. You want to ask Allah for money, for example, for help, for anything you wish. First of all, قل يا كريم, يا رحمن, يا جواد, and use his beautiful names. فلله الأسماء الحسنى فادعوه بها. You can relate and make a connection between what you request in your dua and what you ask. You ask for money, wealth, you have a financial problems. So, يا كريم, يا جواد. Someone who's really, really desperate and he needs to have children, say يا وهاب. Someone who's what? He's got a problem, he's sick, is then you say يا شافي. So every time, and that's why the importance of learning the Asma of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the beautiful names of Allah actually. And then every time you use him, utilize him, and that Allah loves that, and he would answer your dua if you utilize and use his names. قال ولله الأسماء الحسنى فادعوه. يعني يأمرنا الله جل وعلا. He's commanded us. Go ask by using my names. فادعوه بها. We just all very limited to Ya Allah, Ya Allah. It's beautiful, it's nice. But also add to it the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فإذا قال عبدي الرحمن الرحيم قال الله أثنى علي عبدي. So every time you read, Allah is responding. Imagine, think of that. Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, like, think about it. قال فإذا قال مالك يوم الدين قال من جدني عبدي. He has glorified me. فإذا قال إياك نعبد وإياك. This ayah is very important. This is the like Ibn Taymiyyah. هذه الآية التي ما دعا فيها عبد إلا أجاب الله ودعاه. This ayah فيها سر عظيم. This that has so much great secret. قال فإذا قال إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين هذا بيني وبين عبدي. It's between me and my slave. I would know him when he's asking, when he's worshiping me, when he's seeking help and worship me alone. Because it's very something very secret. As we said, why is song is very secret and very special? Nobody knows. Nobody can tell. You're fasting, you know. Before we used to, when children used to say, show me your tongue if you're fasting, or shit, try or not. But it's like, who knows? قال هذا بيني وبين عبدي ولعبدي ما سأل. هذا بيني وبين عبدي دلالة على أن إخلاص العبادة لله دليل بإذن سبب من أسباب استجابتي الدعاء. لأن الله قال هذا بيني وبين عبدي ولعبدي ما سأل. يعني إذا كان مخلص إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. إذا كان مخلص فخلص الإجابة حاصلة. Between me and my slave and for my abd, for my slave, whatever he asks, I will answer. So what is that? Then after that, the second part of the Surah Al-Fatiha, the dua, اهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ. Guide us to the same path. on the path of those who are, you are guided, not the path of those who are, they are misguided, or you are angry, or they go astray. And this is, subhanAllah, is every time, my dear brothers, wallahi, yani, I would like every one of you to remember this hadith. Every time you start the Fatiha, think of that. Allah is responding to you. So we say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, قال حمدني عبدي الرحمن الرحيم أثنى علي عبدي فإذا قال مالك يوم الدين مجدني عبدي glorify me فإذا قال إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين between me and my slave ولعبدي ما سأل اهدنا الصراط المستقيم guide then you ask Allah SWT. One of the things we need to learn, my dear brothers, is the first thing we start by saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم when we say recite Surah Al-Fatiha. And Surah Al-Fatiha, when you say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, you seek refuge in Allah, a protection from the shaitan, the cursed shaitan. الشيطان الملعون الرجيم. So as you know, what really irritates shaitan, what makes him angry, what makes him very irritated and annoyed, extremely, when he sees the Muslim is reading the Quran. So Shaytan, that time he got irritated. So what he would do? He would come to corrupt your intention, to distract you. That's why sometimes you come to read the Quran, there's things you never thought about it, they will come in the time of reading. Because Shaytan said, listen, I tried this man many times, he said to him, let us go to sport, he's not listening to me. Let us watch movie, he's not listening to me. Let us listen to music, he's not listening to me. Now he's reading Quran, okay. What we do? There's another way. Because the shaitan has got so many ways. Let me corrupt his intention. Let me corrupt his mind. First one, you start to think, make you think about football matches, things about the home, at home, your work, your study, whatever comes to your mind. Usually you don't care about your study. Outside the salah, if you don't care, read Quran, you don't care, you don't think about it. You don't care about your. But when it comes to salah, you think you become concerned. Yeah. Why? Because shaitan is whispering. Or sometimes you read the Quran, listen, oh, there's a brother, he's in the corner, he's listening to you, beautify your reading, make it nicer. Then you get praised. That's another way. Or he would come and say, listen, you are a pious person. Look, everyone is, you are the masjid alone and everyone is outside. And you read the Quran, you are guaranteed Jannah. Everyone is sinful and you are, and it makes you up arrogant. And corrupt your qalb, your heart. So try these ways, many ways. A'udhu billah. Mean shaitan. The first thing that he wants is even the salah that he told us. When shaitan comes to your mind, we finish with our words, we go all beyond them. What did he teach us? فَإِذَا جَاءَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَحَدِكُمْ فَلْيَدْفُلْ عَنْ شِمَالِهِ He would spit. And spit in your left and say, أَوْلُ بِلَهِ مِشْطَانِ Do it three times. During the salah. Every time he comes, you think there's a distraction and there's a thought is coming to your mind and you get distracted. Don't spit in your brother. As the Lord said, spit just slightly, lightly. And say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Every time, while you are standing, and because the shaitan, his biggest mission, his biggest task, how can I distract him? How can I mislead him? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. That's one of the levels every time when we think about أعوذ فإذا قرأت القرآن فاستعذ بالله. سبحان الله استعاذ بالله. من الشيطان الرجيم to understand إن الشيطان لكم عدو فاتخذوا عدوا الشيطان is your enemy take him as an enemy don't realize he's an invisible enemy you can't see him he's hidden but he's most dangerous so inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala بإذن الله we will talk about some secret of Surah Al-Fatiha next time and then just make it nice and short for you that inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala you will be able to attend inshallah.